Hi, hello everyone. I'm so happy share with you, sharing with you the time talking about the Bible story from Leviticus chapter 25. It's the sixth week of the 2019 chronological Bible reading. Leviticus chapter 25 starts with the Sabbath year and then the year of Jubilee. The Sabbath day or Sabbath year or even the Jubilee all are based upon the sovereignty of the Lord. Because we are creation of God, God and the earth and human beings are God's creation, and we are depend on God, but actually we are dependent on earth. God is blessing us through earth. So when you rest, the earth also rest. That means if we rest, we do not work, but still we have something to eat. So for example, if we think about the Sabbath year, so this is starting point, the sixth year, and seventh year, and eighth year, and ninth year. So when we work full year of sixth work, but we cannot work all the seventh year, and then the harvest time of the eighth year. So year one, year two, almost year three, we eat from 1 year of the sixth year, the harvest, and we eat almost 3 years. That is absolutely our faithfulness to God. So God is promising us how we could survive without labor, without planting, without harvesting. So this is absolutely we are depend on God's sovereignty and God's lordship and God's blessing. And especially Jubilee, when we read Leviticus chapter 25 verse 8 and 7, count of seven Sabbaths of years, seven times 7 years, so that the seven Sabbaths of years amount to a period of 49 years. Then have a trumpet sounded everywhere on the 10th day of the 7th month, on the Day of Atonement, sound the trumpet throughout your land. So here we word the trumpet. The trumpet is actually made by the horn of a ram. That's in Hebrew, that's a yobel. So English word jubilee came from yobel. So yobel means a horn, and jubilee is the year of reset everything. So if you lose your lordship of your own body, that means you became a slave, you can come back to your home. And when you become when you lost inheritance, you could be, there is a return to your own, return to you. So, if, that means if we sell our inheritance, our property, that means the how many years left to, from, to the next Jubilee. But think about Jubilee is about one term of Jubilee is 50 years, and our lifespan in maximum about 100 years. So one could not even have a chance to have a Jubilee two times in his whole life. That's why it is not like many have chances in our life. And we are not sure in the Bible history how the Israelite people, Israelites, observe this system that much good. But still, this is a very important philosophy about our basic life, our own life, and our own life and our property. There is these two things are inheritance. But a special case is from here, verse 29. If a man sells a house in a walled city, he retains the right of redemption a full year after his sale. During that time, he may redeem it. If it is not redeemed before a full year has passed, the house is in the walled city shall belong permanently to the buyer and his descendants. It is not to be returned to the in the Jubilee. So the walled city, that's more like city style. They could permanently sell or buy a house, but it's not just the walled town. It's like just opened system. They cannot do it. And Leviticus chapter 29 is very similar to Deuteronomy chapter 28. Both chapters are dealing about this system. If we are obey to God, God is breath us through the earth. But if we disobey God, God curses us, breath us. So it is a very important time to understand the whole the Bible story is, could be summarized like this. If we obey God, God blesses us. And if we disobey to God, God curses us. That's the whole Bible story. So when we compare these two chapters, how it describes the blessing and curses, for example, Leviticus chapter 26, it deals with from first verse to 13, it's a blessing, but from 14 to 46, talks about cursing. And Deuteronomy chapter 28 also, from 1 to 19 is a blessing, but 18 through 68 is curse. It's almost four times more curse. Here almost three or four times more curse. So when we think about only blessing, like automatically, that's not the Bible story. Bible always tells us we must obey to the Lord. So when you read verse 43,
For the land will be deserted by them and will enjoy its sources while it is lies desolate without them. They will pay for their sins because they rejected my laws and uphold my decrees.
So, when people disobey God and also vomit them to the other city and also became empty and it will enjoy the Sabbath years. That is exactly happened when southern kingdom Judea was collapsed by the Babylonians and they absolutely enjoyed 70 years of Sabbath years.
And chapter 27 about the redeeming to God.
So when we talking about the two kinds of sin offerings, I mean the mandatory offering to God, mandatory offering to God, one is a sin offering and the other is a guilty offering. Guilty offering must pay off what we make the rules to the other part. If we do to God, even we need to pay to God 120%. So all cases are talking about chapter 27 of Leviticus. And when you read verse from 32, the entire tithe of the herd or flock, every tenth animal that passes under the shepherd's rod will be holy to the Lord. He must not pick out the good from the bad or make any substitution. If he does make a substitution, both the animal and its substitute become holy and cannot be redeemed. So we could illustrate like this. So when the shepherds, if we think about when shepherd has their den for their animal with like stones, and this is the entrance with his rod, and sheep are coming into their den. He counts 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and he says, "Oh, 10th animal is 10th sheep is so much good. If he could change it with 9th or 11th, both of them are holy." So this God is always above them. Now we are in the Numbers. The naming of that this Bible book Numbers, actually the when the Hebrews interpreted the Hebrew Bible into Greek, they put the name of that Bibles. So they picked the number picked the word Numbers for this book, but original word is in the desert. So this book, I think, in the desert is much better naming of this book. But both of them we must understand. So Numbers chapter 1, actually numbering the all the people by the tribes. And the last part of Numbers chapter 1, it talking about the Levites. And let me read from verse 51. Whenever the tabernacle is to move, the Levites are to take it down. And whenever the tabernacle is to be set up, the Levites shall do it. Anyone else who goes near it shall be put to death. The Israelites are to set up their tents by
divisions, each man is in his own camp under his own standard. The Levites, however, are to set up their tents around the tabernacle of the testimony so that wrath will not fall on the Israelite community. The Levites are to be responsible for the care of the tabernacle of the testimony. So we see here clearly the God's way, how God is being with the human beings, not just the Israelites. So God and the high priest and priests and the Levites and the Israelites and all the nations. This is how God is with human beings. So if this order is if it is far from God, God is not that much asking the holy, but when we are near to God, God is very sensitive about the holiness. So we may say, if we close to God, we are dangerous because we are sinners. So that's why God makes order. Everyone is in the order and they could live with God's grace. So even all the nations, they are God's people and they, God is giving them the His grace, but it's more like a general, grace. But when we going to near to God, God is more giving the special grace to the people near to God. So we see this tendency from the whole Bible again and again and repeat and repeat. So in this case, Levites, if there is a tabernacle and the Levites are in camp around the tabernacle, and then Israelites are staying here. So in the most high place is the dwelling place of God. So Levites, they are blocking to the Israelites, and both of them are carrying their lives. And chapter 2 and part of from verse 32, they gave the final numbers of Israelites. These are the Israelites counted according to their families, all those in the camps by their divisions, number 603,550. That means almost they are 600,000. So if we think about their ladies, the women, and their kids, we could easily, they are 2 million. And chapter 3, they are talking about the Aaron's sons and three divisions of Levites. So when we read the Bible from the Genesis and Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, we see the
Jacob, and son Levi. And Levi has three sons.
Three sons, their name is from birth 17. These were the names of the sons of Levi. So first is Gershon, and second is Kohath, and third one is Merari. And grandson of Kohath is Aaron. So all the priests are only Aaron's descendants. So Kohath's other sons' descendants, they are also Levites. And when we read verse 45, chapter 3, take the Levites in the place of the old firstborn of Israel, and the livestock of the Levites in place of their livestock. The Levites are to be mine, and I am the Lord to redeem the 273 firstborn Israelites who exceed the number of the Levites.
So that order, so because the Levites are God's own, so all the first born of the Israelites are redeeming by the Levites, because they are exceeding, the Israelites exceeding 273 numbers, they cannot be redeemed by the Levites, so they pay the money. Redemption money, so they pay five shekels each person, so it's 1,365 shekels.
And chapter 4, about how they distinguish between three division of the Levites. So when we read verse 17, the chapter 4, the Lord said to the Moses and Aaron, see that the Kohathite tribal clans are not cut off from the Levites, so that they may live and not die when they come near the most holy things. To this for them, Aaron and his sons are to go into the sanctuary and assign to each man his work and what he is to carry. But the Kohathites must not go into look at the holy things even for a moment, or they will die.
Not only Kohath, not only all they are not allowed to going into the holy place, they cannot see, they cannot touch it, so they only carry it.
And when I read chapter 5 from verse 11, the test for an unfaithful wife, this is will be a very strange story for us. Because at the last part it says, this then is the law of jealousy when a woman goes astray and defiles herself while married to her husband, or when feelings of jealousy come over a man because he suspects his wife, the priest is to have her stand before the Lord and is to apply this entire law to her. The husband will be innocent of any wrongdoing, but the woman will bear the consequences of her sin.
This is pretty much sexual discrimination between man and husband. We feel the sense, but still this is interpreted as the guarantee of a woman's right.
If there is no system, the woman will be discarded easily, will be discarded by husband, but through this system, maybe it is compared with the liar detector nowadays, and still gives some right to the women, to the wives. But still, it is under the their culture. It's not a standard for the God's viewpoint of the creation, or in church, even in the new heaven and new king, new earth. This we must understand their culture, and this is not exactly same way applied to us to nowadays. And chapter 6 of Numbers talking about Nazirite. So Nazirite, this we understand. This we understand because only Levites and Aaron's descendants could nearly to God for serving Him. So Nazirite is if they are not from that tribe, they so if someone wants to dedicate himself or herself to God, they will do it by this order. And last part of Numbers chapter 6, talking about the priestly blessing, the Lord said to Moses, tell Aaron and his sons, this is how you are to bless the Israelites. Say to them, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. So they will be put, they will put my name on the Israelites and I'll give bless them. So from Genesis chapter 12, from the Abraham and even us, God's blessing is always through human beings. So when we bless someone, God bless him. When we curses someone, this case, if they are not for good for the curse, we may be cursed. So even we are not Aaron's descendants, all the Christians are priests. We must bless everyone. And when we read chapter 7, Moses gave to the descendants of Levites, when the calf and oxen, when we read chapter 7, verse, from verse 7, he gave two calves and four oxen to the Gershonites as their work required, and he gave four calves and eight oxen to the Merarites as their work required. They were all under the direction of Ithamar, son of Aaron, the priest. But Moses did not give any to the Kohathites because they were to carry on their shoulders the holy things for which they were responsible. So, three Kleth, Gerson, Kohath, and Merari, they are using Kelty and oxen, but Kohath, they must use their shoulder. That means that's more important things for God. So they must use their own shoulder. So when we read when David is carrying the ark to the Jerusalem. They are using the oxen and cart, and the disaster happened, and the Uzzah was killed at the scene. So the Kohathites, they are more caring, more important thing, more close to God. And when we read Numbers chapter 7 and last verse, that is 89, we here clearly see how God and Moses talk each other. That means how God is giving his words to Israelites through Moses. So let me read verse 89, chapter 7. When Moses entered the tent of meeting to speak with the Lord, he heard the voice. He doesn't see, but he heard the voice. He heard the voice speaking to him from between the two cherubim above the atonement cover on the ark of the testimony, and he spoke with him. So if this is ark of testimony, the two cherubim, so their wing, and this is atonement cover, and this space, from this space, Moses could hear the God's voice, and he talked to God there. So this is inside of the tabernacle, not just a holy place, the most holy place. So we see Moses is not a priest, but he's going into many times, whenever he needs to, going into the most holy place. So he's above than the high priest, we see that. And chapter 8, how God is distinguishing the Levites. He says Levites is setting apart for the people of Israelites. So they are holding up the Levites like the offering. And when we read chapter 8 from verses from 23, the Lord said to Moses, "This is applies to the Levites. Men 25 years old or more shall come to take part in the work at the tent of meeting, but at the age of 50, they must retire from their regular service and work no longer. They may assist their brothers in performing their duties at the tent of meeting, but they themselves must not do the work. This then is how you are to assign the responsibilities of the Levites." So Levites, they are coming to work from 25. But when we read other part, sometimes it's 30 and retire from 50, but after they retire, they could still help. So from 25 to 30, we may understand they are something like apprentices. So they learn by watching, and they learn practicing by the direction of the more aged Levites. And chapter 9, we read the second Passover. When we read the first verse, the Lord spoke to Moses in the desert of Sinai in the first month of the second year after they came out of Egypt. He said, and let me read verse 4, So Moses told the Israelites to celebrate the Passover, and they did so in the desert of Sinai at twilight on the 14th day of the first month. The Israelites did everything just as the Lord commanded Moses. So, first Passover is happened B.C. 1446, first month, and 14th day, and this is second Sabbath, that means 1445, first month, 14th day. So, from the Exodus chapter 12 and until the Numbers 9, the time flows very slowly, day by day. That is why we read a lot of things, in all things between that, from Exodus chapter 12 and Leviticus and Numbers 9. There is all things within 1 year. All things happened within 1 year. And finally, Numbers 10, they are ready to start their journey into the Canaan. So God is directing them how they move in order, in like entire congregation is like army, so they are using various different sounds of the trumpet. And the ark, because the tabernacle is could disassembled and could be moved with that Israelite, this portable, so the ark is marching with the Israelites, and when they marching, the clouds is going up and going the front line to the Israelites, and the night time the clouds coming into the congregation and like sleeping. So when we read the last part of Numbers chapter 10 and verse 35. From 34, the cloud of the Lord was over them by day when they set out from the camp. Whenever the ark set out, Moses said, "Rise up, O Lord, may your enemies be scattered, may your foes flee before you." Whenever it came to rest, he said, "Return, O Lord, to the countless thousands of Israel." From Numbers 11, we read a lot of episodes, and there is very famous episodes, and there is very important application, gives a very important application for us. Chapter 11, they are complaining about the food because they only have manna. So when I read from chapter 11 verse 4, the rebel with them began to crave other food, and again the Israelites started wailing and said, "If only we had meat to eat." They are missing meat. It's understandable. We remember the fish we ate in Egypt and the cost, they said. They completely gave up their life, their freedom, and they say this, we ate meat and fish, no cost, they say. Also the cucumbers, melons, leeks, onions, and garlics. This is almost 3,400 years ago stories, but what they ate and what they eat today are almost same. And Moses complained to God for about his leadership, because his burdens are too heavy, and God allowed him 70 other leaders. So when 68 people of the 70 were with Moses, God gave them his spirit, but two are missing from that, so they are not even with Moses. They are they get along the also the spirit of God. And when we read birth from 26, however, two men whose names were Eldad and Medad had remained in the camp. They were listed among the elders, but did not go out to the tent. Yet the Spirit also rested on them, and they prophesied in the camp. A young man ran and told Moses, "Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp." Joshua, son of Nun, who had been Moses' aide since youth, spoke up and said, "Moses, my lord, stop them!" But Moses replied, "Are you jealous for my sake? I wish that all the Lord's people were prophets, and that the Lord would put his spirit on them." So we think Moses is like a dictative leader, but he is not. He is standing with God, but he is also standing for the people. So in our day's viewpoint, he's very like a democratic leader. And chapter 12, unhappy story about Miriam, Aaron, and Moses. Verse 4, it says Miriam and Aaron began to talk against Moses because of his Cushite wife, for he had married a Cushite. So we may guess at this time Moses' wife, Shiphrah, is already dead. That's why Moses married again a lady, but she is a Cushite. That means Moses has no racial discrimination. So when the Israelites came from Egypt, a lot of other rebels are coming with them. So he picked, he chose a lady as his second wife from the Cushite lady. But Miriam, who is the sister-in-law of the Cushite wife, is unhappy about that. That's why Miriam is leading that talking against Moses with Aaron. That's why God is unhappy about that. So God is calling three of them, and finally God gave the punishment to Miriam with the leprosy. So Moses prayed for her, and God, so from verse 13, so Moses cried out to the Lord, "O God, please heal her." The Lord replied to Moses, "If her father had spit in her face, would she not have been in disgrace for 7 days? Confine her outside the camp for 7 days. After that, she can be brought back." So this is God's punishment. Still God is giving grace to her, and all the campers are staying with her 7 days. And finally, Numbers chapter 13. So Numbers chapter 13 is like an original sin for the Israelites. Because it is almost, they passed almost 1 year, and they are all camped near the Kadesh Barnea. It's the, like south of the Israel, the Canaan, near the Negev. So they could come into the Canaan from south to the, directly to the north. But they asked God, when we read Deuteronomy, they asked to send some spies. So they picked up 12 spies, but we must remember two names when we read verse 6. From the tribe of Judah, Caleb, son of Jephunneh, is Caleb. And from verse 8, from the tribe of Ephraim, Hosea, son of Nun. Hosea. So Hosea, Moses changed his name, Joshua. So almost say this both of them meanings are salvation. And even Jesus, Hosea, Hosea, Joshua, and Hosea, and Jesus all has meaning the meaning of salvation. And including these two people, all 12 spies, they were sending by Moses. And Moses talking to them, verse from 17, when Moses sent them to explore Canaan, he said, go up through the Negev, this is Negev, go up through the Negev, and go into the hill country and see what the land is like and whether the people who live there are strong or weak, few or many, what kind of land do they live in, is it good or bad, what kind of towns do they live in, are they onward or fortified, how is the soil? Is it fertile or poor? Are there trees on it or not? Do your best to bring back some of the fruit of the land. It was a season for the first ripe of grape. So when they were sending, they were going to almost entrance of the Hamath, and they returned. There, when they returned, and they reported to their result of the journey, when we read verse 30, then Caleb silenced the people of before Moses and said, we should go up and take possession of the land, for we can certainly do it. But the man who had gone up with him said, we can't attack those people. They were stronger than we are, and they spread among the Israelites a bad report about the land they had explored. They said, the land we explored divorce those living in it. All the people we saw there are the great size. We saw the Nephilim there. The descendants of Anak come from the Nephilim. We seemed like grasshoppers in our own eyes, and we looked the same to them. This is so poor self-esteem. So let us think about how God is dealing me. and myself and from others and how Satan. So we must listen to God, and we listen to others, listen to Satan, and sometimes we listen from ourselves. That is a wrong answer. Whatever Satan say to us is, kill yourself. But whatever God is talking with us, even He's mad with us, still His intention to us is, I love you. I want to be with you. I want to work with you. So we must listen to God. And from the part of chapter 14, that night all the people of the community raised their voices and wept aloud. All the Israelites grumbled against Moses and Aaron, and the whole assembly said to them, if only we had died in Egypt, or in this desert. Why the Lord bring us to this land only to let us fall by the sword? Our wives and children will be taken as plunder. Wouldn't it be better for us to go back to Egypt? So, when people are saying we need to go to Egypt, God is mostly disappointing. God is so mad about that because there's truly against God's plan for making them as the people of His own nation and using them for the priest countries for the whole nations. And Caleb said, when verse 4, and they said to each other, we should choose a leader and go back to Egypt. And both Moses cannot say anything, so that's why then Moses and Aaron fell face down in the front of the whole Israelites assembly gathered there. And Joshua, son of Nun, and Caleb, son of Jephunneh, were among those who had explored the land, tore their clothes. And he said, and said to the entire Israelite assembly, the land we passed through and explored exceedingly good. If the Lord is pleased with us, He will lead us into that land, a land flowing with milk and honey, and will give it to us. Only do not rebel against the Lord, and do not be afraid of the people of the land, because we'll swallow them up. Their protection is gone, by the Lord is with us, and do not be afraid of them. This is a kind of hold Israelite original sin. And God is almost giving up them, but Moses intercede and he prayed to God, and God is answering Moses' prayer, but God is way of discipline is they must stay in the desert 39 more years, and all the people who were above 20 years when they crossed the Red Sea, they all died in the desert, and their children becoming the adults, and their children are going into the Canaan. So, this is what we read from verse 33. Your children will be shepherds here for 40 years, suffering for your unfaithfulness until the last of your bodies lies in the desert. For 40 years, 1 year for each of the 40 days you explore the land, you will suffer for your sins and know what it is like to have me against you. So this is wisdom. Our life must obey to the Lord. We must go with God. And finally, this is point we need to see, we need to read the Psalm 90, because it is written by Moses. Psalm 90, a prayer of Moses, the man of God. Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. God has a dwelling place in the among the Israelites, and Moses sang, God is their own dwelling place. Before the mountains were born of Oar, you brought forth the earth and the world from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. And this is one of the famous verses when we read 10. The length of our days is 70 years, or 80 if we have the strength, yet their span is but trouble and sorrow, for they quickly pass, and we fly away. And verse 12, teach us the number of our days aright, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. So, Moses alive until 120 years, but he said the average people, if they could live 70, and if they are healthy, they could be 80. Even God allowed 120 lifespan, years in the lifespan to Noah, but usually at the time still people could live until 60 or 70 years. And when we understand our life in the world is not forever, that automatically gives us the wisdom how we have to live on the earth. On the earth. And when we read Numbers 15, it is again the talking about the offerings. And last part of Numbers 16 is very interesting story. The Lord said to Moses, speak to the Israelites and say to them, throughout the generations to come you are to make tassels on the corners of your garments with a blue cord on each tassel. You will have these tassels to look at, and so you will remember all the commands of the Lord, then you may obey them and not prostitute yourselves by going after the lusts of your own hearts and eyes. So they are Israelites, not a Levites, not a priests, whole the Israelites. God is asking, being set apart, being staying the holiness. And chapter 16, again the talking about the Korah, Dathan, and Abiram. This is a very interesting three people. Korah, Dathan, and Abiram. This is a Levite. He wants to be priest. And this is not Levites, but they wanted to have political power. So Korah is against Aaron, and they are against to Moses. And they say, they and 2,250 leaders are standing with them. And they came from verse 3. They came as a group to oppose Moses and Aaron and said to them, "You have gone too far. The whole community is holy, and every one of them, and the Lord is with them. Why then you do set yourselves above the Lord's assembly?" Moses never did it. God chose him. God chose Moses and Aaron. But they want to their position like priests and leader, like king. And so Moses ordered all of that 250 leaders bring their own censer, and whom God will choose as their leaders. And Moses himself tell to them, and especially to the Korah, verse 7, from verse 6, "You, Korah, and all your followers are to do this. Take censers, and tomorrow put fire and incense in them before the Lord. The man the Lord chooses will be the one who is holy. You Levites have gone too far." So they say to Moses, "You have Moses and Aaron, you have gone too far." And Moses say to them, "You have gone too far." And people are watching over how it's going on. This is very, very strange story. And finally, God punished them. And even the older people got the have the disease, so they are dying. So when we read verse 46, then Moses said to Aaron, "Take your censer and put incense in it, along with fire from the altar, and hurry to the assembly to make atonement for them. Wrath has come out from the Lord. The plague has started." So Aaron did as Moses said and ran into the midst of the assembly. The plague had already started among the people, but Aaron offered the incense and made atonement for them. He stood between the living and the dead, and the plague stopped. So this is an actual story, but it has a lot of symbolic meaning. The priests are standing between the live, between the living and the dead. So that's a dangerous place, but the priest must stand there. And chapter 17 continues. Who will be the priests? So Moses asked them bring the staff from 12 tribes, actually 13, and from the Levites, he picked the Aaron. So finally, when we read verse 8, the next day Moses entered the tent of the meeting and saw that Aaron's staff, which represented the house of Levi, had not only sprouted but had budded, blossomed, and produced almonds. And this is a very strong sign from God. And chapter 18 is talking about the priests and Levites again, and how the system is working. When we read from verse 25, the Lord said to Moses, "Speak to the Levites and say to them, When you receive from the Israelites the tithe I give you as your inheritance, you must present a tenth of the tithe as the Lord's offering. Your offering will be reckoned to you as grain from the threshing floor and juice from the wine press.
So, Israelites and Levites and priests and God. So, Israelites give the tithe and Levites give the tithe from their tithe to priests.
That's the system. And chapter 19, they are preparing the atoning water, cleansing water from the cow. Red color cow from that ashes. So when we read verse 13, whoever touches the dead body of anyone and fails to purify himself but defiles the Lord's tabernacle, that person must be cut off from Israel, because the water of cleansing has not been sprinkled on him. He is unclean, his uncleanness remains on him. So we understand that because the cow is dying for atoning way, and the water put that ash in there is cleansing the people with sin. And chapter 20 of Numbers, exactly happened at the Kadesh Barnea, when people have no water to drink for themselves and their livestock, they are complaining to Moses. So God is talking to Moses from verse 7. The Lord said to Moses, take the staff, and your brother Aaron gather the assembly together, speak to the rock before their eyes, and it will pour out its water. You will bring water out of the rock for the community, so they and their livestock can drink. So Moses took the staff from the Lord's presence, just as he commanded him. He and Aaron gathered the assembly together in front of the rock, and Moses said to them, listen, you rebels, must we bring you water out of this rock? Then Moses raised his arm and struck the rock twice with his staff, water gushed out, and the community and their livestock drank. It looks okay, but God talked to Moses, speak to the rock. Speak to that rock. But he struck the rock twice. And let me read verse 12. But the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, because you did not trust in me enough to honor me as holy in the sight of the Israelites, you will not bring this community into the land I give them. This is again God and Moses and Aaron and the whole Israelites. So Moses is most clear, close to God. He must show God's holiness. Let me read again. Because you did not trust in me enough to honor me as holy in the sight of the Israel. So Israelites must see from Moses three things here: how trust the God, and how honor God, and how holy. So this incident breaks all of them. God clearly say you cannot lead them into that people into the Canaan. So this is we understand that when we close to God, we are asking more, trusting Him, more holy, more honor Him. And last part of chapter 20, the death of Aaron. Verse from 24, Aaron will be gathered to his people. He will not enter the land I give the Israelites, because both of you, Moses and Aaron, rebelled against my command at the waters of Meribah. Get Aaron and his son Eleazar and take them up Mount Hor. Remove Aaron's garments and put them on his son Eleazar, for Aaron will be gathered to his people. He will die there. So when you think about this, when they going up to the mountain, Aaron is dying there. So that means he is still have power until his day of death. That case is the same to the Moses. And chapter 21, we read the story about the snakes. The people are grumbling again to the Lord because of the Lord. So he sent the venomous snakes among them without the warning, and people are dying. So Moses get the answer from the Lord that he said, make a pole midst of the community, pole, and make a bronze snake and hang there. Bronze snake. How can I draw it? Something like this. And whoever sees that bronze snake, they will be healed. And when we read John chapter 3, verse from 14, Jesus talking about this incident. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in Him may have eternal life. So, on the cross, our Lord is hang on the cross. So, when whoever sees the snake be healed, whoever sees Him and believes in Him, he will get the everlasting life, eternal life. Yeah. So this the incident in Numbers 21 and John 3 is perfectly matching each other. And when we read verse 16-17, from there they continued on the beer. The beer is the meaning of the well. The well where the Lord said to Moses, gather the people together and I will give them water. Then Israel sang this song, spring up, O well, sing about it, about the well that the princes dug, that the navels of the people sank, the navels with scepters and staffs. Then they went from the desert to Metana. So this is story about the well, the well. Because our life depends on water and food, and God is giving us water and food. And from chapter 22. Is a story about Balak and Balaam. It's always confusion. Balak. Balak and Balaam.
So this is a fourth prophet, and Balaam is a king of Moab. So he was using his prophecy, his cursing for destroying the Israelites. Here we see again the God's two wills. So one is an absolute will, and the other one is like a permissive will. So absolute will is absolute. The permissive will is God is allowing them. That is not God's will. So when Balaam is leaning to follow Balak's idea, God finally allowed him to go with their people, but God is using him, and that situation is unhappy. That's why God is sending his angel, and even Balaam's donkey see the angels. So when we read verse 23, when the donkey saw the angel of the Lord standing in the road with a drawn sword in his hand, she turned off the road into a field. Balaam beat her to get her back on the road. Then the angel of the Lord stood in a narrow path between two vineyards with walls on both sides. When the donkey saw the angel of the Lord, she pressed close to the staff, crossing Balaam's foot against it, so he beat her again. Then the angel of the Lord moved on ahead and stood in a narrow place where there was no room to turn, either to the right or to the left. And they are talking again, they are fighting again, and but still Balaam did not return to his hometown. So when we read the last part of the chapter 22, Numbers, from verse 36, when Balak heard that Balaam was coming, he went out to meet him at the Moabite town on the Arnon border at the edge of his territory. Balak said to Balaam, "Why did I not send you an urgent summons? Why didn't you come to me? Am I really not able to reward you?" And Balaam said, "Well, I have come to you now," Balaam replied, "but can I say just anything? I must speak only what God puts in my mouth." So when he speak what God puts in his mouth, he's okay. But when he is doing something out of God's will, there was a disaster. So let us talking about this thing after when we read more. And I am very happy to be with you about with the story of the Bible. And if you have any idea, let me know and discuss with me at the replies comments. I'm more than welcome about that. Thank you very much.